Hello, good morning and welcome back to the lecture series on limit state design of concrete beam. Okay, to start with, please let me know if you am not if I am not audible properly. If there is a problem in sound, please let us know. So, okay, it seems you all can hear me properly. Okay, let us start. We'll start from the yes. Okay, this was the last. If you recall, can I see the slide? Yeah, thank you. Okay, if you remember, this was the last slide. Okay, so what we have done so far is we discussed the assumptions which constitute the design philosophy of limit state method, and then we also discussed the interpretation of this assumption, the physical interpretation of these assumptions, and also in what way these assumptions help in forming the design philosophies. Now, then we also discussed that there are three kinds of sections we will encounter. One is balance section. The reinforced concrete, essentially we have two material, one is concrete and one is steel, and their behavior are very different. The one behaves in a brittle way, concrete, and steel behaves in a ductile way. So, we also have seen what is the meaning of brittle failure and what is the meaning of ductile failure. And we want our structure always to be ductile, so that before it fails, it gives us sufficient warning, so that any safety measure that we need to take before it fails, that we can be, that can be taken. Now, depending on how much steel you are providing in a structure, there are three kinds of sections, beam sections. One is balance section. Balance section is when concrete and steel both reach their limit state of failure simultaneously, and in balance section means a balance is maintained between the failure of concrete and the failure of steel, and in balance section concrete and steel fail at the same time. Now, under reinforced section is where the steel reaches its limit state first than the concrete, and therefore the failure is governed by, the failure of entire section is governed by the failure of steel, and since the failure of steel is ductile, so entire section behaves in a ductile manner. And then we have over reinforced section where the failure is governed by concrete, because concrete fails first, and therefore the failure of the entire section is a brittle failure. Now, as name suggests, under reinforced section means the reinforcement that you are providing in a section is lesser than the balance section. Then what happens? You are providing less amount of steel than the balance section, and therefore you are making steel, you are forcing the steel reinforcement to fail first, because the amount of amount of steel is less, and therefore the whatever forces you have, that has to be taken care of, taken by the less number of steel. Naturally, the stresses in each steel will be more, and therefore it will fail fast. That is why it is called under reinforced section. And over reinforced section means you are providing more steel than the balance section. So, essentially you are not allowing the steel members to fail, because the amount of steel is more, and therefore the failure is governed by failure of the entire section is governed by failure of concrete. And now we don't want our section to be brittle. That's why over reinforced section, we don't design over reinforced section. Always we try to design under reinforced section. Okay. Now, and these things, how we design, how to ensure that at the design stage, that will be discussed shortly. Now, what we'll do now is we'll derive the equations for balance sections, and then from balance section we'll see when the section becomes under reinforced and when the section becomes over reinforced. Okay, okay. So let us see. Let us start balance section. Okay, so we have already discussed these figures, right? We have already discussed these strain diagrams and then stress diagram. Now, as I said yesterday, if you have understood how these strain diagram and stress diagrams are obtained, then the rest of the things are just some algebraic manipulation. Rest of the things are just writing governing equilibrium and compatibility equations on these strain and stress diagrams. Okay. Now, one important thing, if you remember, in one of the assumption was the strain in the extreme strain in steel, the tensile strain in steel shall not be less than this value. This shall not be less than this value because you want the strain in steel to be more, right? So that the so that the failure of steel is ensured before concrete. Now, since we are talking about balance section. And in balance section, the failure of concrete and steel happen together. Therefore, the both reach their limit state simultaneously. So, what happens? We take the strain in the extreme strain in the tension side, at the point where you have steels is this value. The greater than sign is greater than equal to sign. Now we use equal to sign. Okay. The strain is here, this, and this is the strain 0.0035, we have discussed this, and this is the corresponding stress diagram. Now, next thing is writing just equilibrium equation on this and compatibility equation on this. Okay. Now from this and x1 and x2, if you recall that x1 is the portion where your stress is constant. And from x2 is the portion where the stress is compressive stress is parabolic. Okay. Now, so if we apply the similar triangle between this triangle and this triangle, we get an expression for expression of x1 and x2 in terms of x u, and x u is the depth of neutral axis. Depth of neutral axis is defined as the depth from the extreme compression fiber to the neutral axis. So, x1 and x2 can be written in terms of depth of neutral axis xu as this. Now, let us see what is the total compression on this side, and what is the total tension at this point. Now, total compression is, you have two parts, one is the parabolic part and one is rectangular part. Now, the rectangular part is C1, and which is 0.446 FCK into X1, 0.446 FCK into X1, X1 is equal to 3XU by 7, and B is equal to width of the concrete. So, essentially this gives you the this area. So, this area multiplied by the intensity of the stress gives you the total compression on this area, only the rectangular part. So, C1 is this. Now, similarly, we can get C2. C2 is the area of this multiplied by the width of the beam. Area is a parabolic section. So, this gives you the area of this and multiplied by the width of the section, and this gives you C2. So, then total compression on the upper portion of the neutral axis is equal to C is equal to C1 plus C2, C is equal to C1 plus C2, and this comes as this. Okay. So, this is the total compression on the compression side on the portion above the neutral axis. And what is the total tension? As we discussed in the last class, the portion below the neutral axis, the concrete portion, the section below the neutral axis will not take any tension. The entire tension has to be taken by the steel reinforcements. And if the area of reinforcement is AST, area of steel under tension, and the stress in steel is equal to the characteristic, the design strength of steel, which is characteristic strength divided by the partial safety factor, which is 1.15 for steel, which gives you 0.87 Fy. So, T is equal to 0.87 Fy into area of steel, this is the total tension. So, this is total compression and this is total tension. And A is equal to, suppose the resultant of this compression, the C1 and C2 is this C, and this, the point of action of C is this, and this distance of C from the top extreme compression fiber is A. And if you can, and we know how to determine the centroid of a section, and if you apply that, you get A is equal to this value. In many cases, many book you will see it is written as 0.42 xu. Okay. So these, all these expression is just the geometric, you can obtain from geometry of this. Okay. Now, so once we have total compression, now we have here, this is the total compression, this is the total tension. Now, irrespective of the size of the irrespective of the size of the section, the amount of reinforcement, the equilibrium has to be maintained. And here the equilibrium, if you remember the equation for static equilibrium, equation of static equilibrium is equal to summation of forces in a particular direction is equal to 0, and summation of moments in a particular direction is equal to 0, right. So, what we write now is the equilibrium equation on this. Now, this is the total compression and this is the total tension, and equilibrium says that total compression has to be equal to total tension irrespective of the kind of section you have, whether it is a rectangular section, non-rectangular section, anything, irrespective of anything, this equilibrium has to be maintained. Now, total tension is equal to this, total compression is equal to this, just now we have seen this, and if you write it like this, then AST by BD, AST is the area of steel for tension, and B into D is the area of the concrete, area of the section, and AST by BD gives you essentially the percentage of reinforcement given. Please note here, when you calculate the percentage of reinforcement, it is not capital D, it is small d used, means it is not the total overall depth of the section, it is the effective depth needs to be used. You may ask that why effective depth, why not the total depth? The answer is very straightforward, because in this expression we used small d. Okay, the expression is, entire expression is expressed in with by putting small d. Okay, so that is how PT is defined. Now then, this expression can be written as this. Okay. Now, you see, so now you see, for a given grade of concrete and given grade of steel, we know what is the value of Fy and what is the value of Fck. Okay. Before that, so this is the equilibrium condition. Now, if you remember equilibrium condition, you might have done in strength of material on and mechanics also, that when we write equilibrium equation alone, not sufficient to determine all the unknowns, then equilibrium, along with the equilibrium equation, we need to use the compatibility conditions. Compatibility conditions, it is more a geometric condition, how the sections are, whether the deformation is any portion of the, if we take an entire section, it cannot happen that the deformation at any portion should be consistent with the deformation in other portion. And this geometric condition, geometric constraint, can be written in terms of compatibility condition. Now, in this thing, what is the compatibility condition? Compatibility condition says that, you see, we said that 0.035 is the strain in extreme compression fiber. We also said that 0.87 Fy by ES plus 0.002 is the strain in extreme tension fiber, or this side. Okay. So, these values are obtained, 0.0035 and these values are obtained from the material property, from experiment on materials. Okay. This is obtained from material characterization. Now, along with that, so this is the material characterization. Along with that, you have one more assumption, that your strain should be linear. Any section which is normal to the axis, longitudinal axis of the beam before deformation, remain neutral axis before deformation, remain perpendicular to the neutral axis and remain plane even after deformation. And the immediate implication is the strain diagram across the depth, longitudinal strain across the depth is linear, and this linearity is another assumption. Okay. Now, you may have several assumptions, but the one assumption should not contradict other. One assumption should not be so all these assumptions should be compatible with each other. Now, we have two assumptions. One is the strain in extreme fibers and another assumption is strain distribution is linear. These two assumptions should be compatible to each other, and it may happen when your depth of neutral axis is such, value of xu is such that it is respected, these values are respected. Okay. And this is the compatibility condition. Compatibility condition means that your depth of neutral axis should be dependent on these assumptions. The assumptions are the tension is this, tensile strain is this, compressive strain is this, and linear, this strain distribution is linear. Okay. So, your depth of neutral axis should be such that this distribution along with this value should be achieved. Okay. Now, if we apply similar triangle concept here, then we get this expression, and this is compatibility equation. It says that the value of xu cannot be anything. The value of xu, the value of depth of neutral axis should be such that these assumptions, the assumptions on the strain distribution should be compatible. Okay. Now, this is the compatibility condition. Now, you see in this expression, if we know what is the grade of steel, we have, it could be Fe415, it could be yield strengths of steel, it could be 250 megapascal, 415 megapascal, 500 megapascal or any other values. We have, depending on the grade of steel, we have different values of Fy. Okay. Another important characteristic of steel that is observed through experiment, that irrespective of the grade of steel you have, you have different yield stress. But the Young's modulus is almost remains same for 250, 415, 500, all these steels, the Young's modulus remains almost same, and this Young's modulus value of Young's modulus is approximately 200 GPa. So, in this expression, ES is 200 GPa irrespective of the grade of steel, and Fy depends on grade of steel. And another interesting observation is, you see in this expression there is no information about the grade of concrete you use. It means that irrespective of the grade of concrete, this depth of neutral axis only depends on the grade of steel. Okay. The reason is this 0.0035, the information of concrete is still there, failure of concrete is still there, which is this 0.0035 is essentially the maximum strain in concrete. Why this expression is independent of grade of strain, grade of steel, grade of concrete? Because irrespective of the grade of concrete, this 0.0035, the maximum strain, maximum allowable strain is maximum allowable strain 0.0035 remain same. That is why this expression does not depend on the grade of concrete. Now, if you have different grade of steel, substitute the values of Fy and then you get xu by d is equal to this. Sorry, xu by d is equal to this. Okay. Now, so for a balanced section, if we know the section is balanced section, then you can determine, if you know the grade of steel, then you can determine the depth of neutral axis from this table. Okay. Now, so again, in coming back to the equilibrium condition once again, now from this expression, we substitute Pt as Ast by Bd into 100 in this expression and we get this value. Okay. Now, okay, this is the summary of equation of balance section. This is the compression, total compression, this is total tension, and this is the expression of percentage of steel just now we have seen in the previous slide, and this is the A lever arm, it gives you the lever arm D minus A. A is the centroid of C, the point of action of C from the extreme compression fiber that we can obtain from properties of this area. And now, so this is we have seen. We also have seen that for different grade of steel, what is the value of x u by d. So, you know the grade of steel and you know what is the effective depth of a section, you can determine the depth of neutral axis, straightforward. Okay. Now, then what is the moment of resistance? Moment of resistance is what? Now, moment of resistance is the, as name suggests, it is the moment that a section can resist. Okay. Now, a beam section is applied some load. If you take a it's simply supported beam subjected to UDL, for instance, you take any section, then you know what is the bending moment at that section. Now, what happens? That is the bending moment induced at that section because of the external loading, right? Now, the section has some resistance, and if that resistance to the moment, if that resistance is less than the moment induced by the external load, then we say that the section is not capable to resist the moment. And if the resistance of the section is more than the induced moment, then we can say that the section is capable to take care of the moment because of the external loading. So, always our design principle is to make our section, the make the moment of resistance such that it should be capable to resist the external applied moment. So, we need to understand how this moment of resistance can be calculated. It is very straightforward. You see, this is the compression and this is the tension. We have already seen that equilibrium says that compression is equal to tension irrespective of the kind of section you are dealing with. Now the distance between compression and tension is equal to D minus A. This is called the lever arm. So, what is the moment due to this? Moment will be compression multiplied by this lever arm or tension multiplied by this lever arm. Okay. Now, if you substitute C here, C is equal to 0.36 FCKB, then substitute C here and do some and substitute A, value of A is this, then you get mu by BD square is equal to this expression. Okay. Now, you see that mu by BD square, this expression depends on XU by D and depends on FCK. Okay. Now, for different grade of steel, we know what is the different XU by D and substitute different XU by D and we get mu by BD square, this mu is equal to the expression of mu is equal to these values for different grade of steel. Okay. So, these values are called balanced moment of resistance, means the moment of resistance of a balanced section. Probably these things will be clear when we actually demonstrate all these expressions through some example. So, why we could write the x u by d mu in a very simple form for a balanced section. The reason is here in the strain, we assume instead of making it greater than equal to 0.87 Fy by Es plus 0.002, we made it equal to 0.87 Ei Es plus 0.002. Okay. Now, when you make it, but for other section, for under reinforced section, we cannot say the strain in steel is exactly this value. In under reinforced section, the strain has to be greater than this value. When you say something is greater than this, then there is uncertain. This solution is open, right? Because something is greater than, strain is greater than this value, means strain could be anything. But when, so strain is essentially unknown there, but in balanced section, when you say that strain is exactly this, the strain is known. Since this value is known, we could apply the compatibility condition on this diagram to get x u. And once we know xu, we can substitute xu here to get this expression for moment. So precisely, since for balance section we can say that the strain in the steel fiber, steel reinforcement is exactly equal to this, we can have this simple form of moments and depth of neutral axis. But this we do not have when the section becomes under reinforced section. Okay, so but before that let us try to understand. If you have any question on these slides, we'll definitely discuss towards the end of this lecture. Now let us try to understand what is balanced under reinforced and over reinforced section. Now we have already discussed, as the name suggests, the balance section is there is a balance maintained between the steel and the concrete failure. They both reach their limit state simultaneously. Under reinforced section, you provide the reinforcement lesser than the balance section, so that you are forcing steel to fail fast, and that's why failure is ductile. And over reinforced section, we give more steel. Therefore, we are forcing concrete to fail first, not the steel, and therefore failure is brittle. Now, and for balance section, suppose this is the strain diagram. Okay. Now, take first, but irrespective of whether your section is under reinforced, over reinforced, or balanced. Okay, you see the definition of under reinforced, over reinforced, and balanced section is based on amount of steel you are giving, whether you are allowing steel to fail first or not, and that is controlled by providing lesser steel than the balanced section, or more steel than the balance section. But irrespective of that, the strain in concrete, which is 0.0035, the limit state of concrete remain always same. So now this is the strain diagram. It is the same strain diagram. This is the same strain diagram. Okay. Now we have seen the for balance section, the strain diagram is 0.0035 at the top and this value at the bottom. Okay. So, the green curve, the green is essentially the blue one is essentially the strain diagram for balance section. It is 0.0035 and this value is exactly equal to this. This is for balance section. Okay. Now, and for balance section, when your epsilon s, which is the strain in steel, when epsilon x becomes this, then we can write that this xu for different grade of steel, what is xu by d. Right now, do not bother about what is xu comma limiting. We will just come to that point shortly. So, we know that for balance section for different grade of steel, this is the xu by d. So, we know the depth, effective depth, we can calculate what is the depth of neutral axis. Okay, that comes directly from the compatibility equation, directly from this diagram, similar triangle. Okay. Now, the red one, now the green one, what is the characteristic of green one? Green one is the strain in steel is greater than epsilon 0, greater than this strain. Okay. Means you are allowing steel to have more strain. More strain means what? You're allowing steel to reach their limit state fast, so that it fail fast. Okay. So, for balance section, for under reinforced section, this green one is the distribution of strain diagram across the depth. Now, for over reinforced section, you provide more steel. Okay. Now, since if you provide more steel, then what happens? The same amount of load is shared by more steel, and therefore effectively in each steel the strain is less, and the strain is lesser than the strain, lesser than this value. So, for balance section, for an over reinforced section, the red one is the strain diagram. This is very important. If you have understood this, then there will be no confusion between the balance, under reinforced, and over reinforced section. So, blue one is the balance section, where you take the strain, exact strain at the steel exactly equal to this value. For under reinforced section, you allow steel to have more strain to reach the limit state first. Therefore, the steel strain is more than this value and you get the green curve, green diagram. And for over reinforced section, the amount of steel is provided lesser than the balance section. Therefore, steel strain is lesser than this value and you get the red diagram for over reinforced section. Now, once you have understood three strain diagram, let us see what happens to the depth of neutral axis. You see, from balance section, if your section becomes under reinforced, means your strain diagram strain increases in this direction, you get a green curve, your depth of neutral axis is lesser than the depth of neutral axis of the balance section. Okay. So, but for over reinforced section, when your strain in steel is lesser than this value, means your strain is somewhere in this zone, then you get a red curve and the depth of neutral axis, this one, is more than the balance section. Okay. Now, if you look at this diagram carefully, irrespective the value, irrespective the green curve and the red curve, location of green and red curve, if your section is under reinforced section, always you get depth of neutral axis less than the balance section. And if you make your section over reinforced, as per this diagram, your depth of neutral axis becomes more than the balance section, right? Now, what happens, as we mentioned, we do not want over reinforced section, we do not want our structure to behave in a brittle manner. Okay. So, the blue one is our limiting, always we want our section to have strain diagram any of this green in this direction. Okay. And the limiting case will be the blue one. We don't want our strain less than this value, means we don't want the immediate implication is we don't want the neutral axis to be more than the depth of neutral axis of balance section. So, you always want our neutral axis to be lesser than the depth of neutral axis of balance section, and by making that, by we can ensure that our section is always under reinforced section, and therefore, the failure will be ductile in nature. But so, therefore, this is the limiting, the maximum depth of neutral axis that we can allow a section to have. Okay, because if we cross this limit, then essentially you are making our section over reinforced. So, this is the maximum depth of neutral axis or limiting depth of neutral axis. That is why for balance section, whenever we refer the depth of neutral axis for balance section, we say XU maximum, because that is the maximum depth of neutral axis, and or sometimes XU limiting, because this is the maximum, this is the limiting depth of neutral axis. You should not have depth of neutral axis more than these limiting values. Okay. And these limiting values for a different grade of steel can be obtained from this. Okay. Now, but irrespective of whether it is a balanced, over reinforced or under reinforced section, your strain in concrete remain 0.0035. It is the strain in steel which changes depending on the section you are designing. Okay, once we have understood this, let us see what is the modification required. So, this is the summary for balance section. Now, again, for balance section, since we can say this is the strain diagram, the blue one is the strain diagram, which is one unique strain diagram, we know the values, and therefore, we can write all these expression in a very simplified form. But for under reinforced section, the depth of neutral axis could be anything in this direction. Strain diagram could be anything in this direction, and therefore, strain in steel is also an unknown. But for balance section, which is not unknown, because the balance section, this is this values. Okay. So, therefore, we will see for under reinforced section, we cannot write the depth of neutral axis in this simplified form. Let us see what is under reinforced section. What is changes for under reinforced section? Now, compression, total compression remains same. This is the total compression, because But only thing is, this depth of neutral axis is not the depth of neutral axis of balance section. This depth of neutral axis can be obtained, cannot be obtained from the simplified values for different grade. So, this is unknown, but that was not unknown for balance section. Okay. Tension in steel is again a tension in steel remains same, it is the design strength multiplied by the area which is remains same. The equilibrium equation, irrespective of whether it is a balance section or under reinforced section, the equilibrium has to be maintained and therefore, total compression has to be equal to total tension. Okay. Now, if we apply total compression is equal to total tension, we get this expression of percentage of steel the similar way that we have obtained for balance section. But the only difference, I repeat this many times, only difference is here x u by d for under reinforced section cannot be replaced by these values. If we replace x u by d here by these values, then your section is balanced section. But for under reinforced section, we do not know the x u by d value, that needs to be determined. For balanced section it is known, and therefore, under reinforced section this is also unknown, x u by d is also unknown. The equations what you get, the form of the equations are exactly similar for balanced section, under reinforced section. Now, if you substitute x u by d for balance section, you get expression for balance section. But if you make x, if you don't substitute, if you determine the x u by d assuming it is an under reinforced section, then all these expression you get for under reinforced section. A also remains same, this gives the lever arm d minus a. Moment of resistance, definition of moment of resistance, the resistance offered by the section again remains same. It is the compression multiplied the lever arm or tension multiplied the lever arm, both ways should get the same value because compression has to be equal to tension, that is the equilibrium condition. Now, if you substitute C from this, you get this expression. And similar expression you obtain for balance section as well, you see, for balance section as well. Now, in this expression, for balance section what we did, balance section we substituted x u by d from this and therefore, we could obtain this, but that cannot be done for under reinforced section, and therefore, under reinforced section needs to be. So, this is a nonlinear equation, a quadratic equation for x u by d. We need to solve this equation to get the x u by d values. Okay. The only difference between the balance as far as these equations are concerned, the only difference because between balance section and under reinforced section you get, because in balance section you substitute x u by d from the respective values for different grade of steel, but for under reinforced you cannot do that, and therefore, you have an expression, nonlinear equation that needs to be solved. How it is to be done, we'll see in the in some examples. Okay. So, let us see two example. Okay. Whatever equations we have derived to understand that, let us take two examples and then see how those equations can be obtained. Okay. You see, there are different kinds of problem. There are different kinds of problem that you may have to encounter. One problem is a design problem. Straightforward, a design problem. You are given the bending moment and shear force for a section, for a given beam, and you were asked to design the beam. And when you were asked to design a beam, means you have to do everything. You have to choose a section, cross section of the beam. You have to see whether it is a rectangular section, non-rectangular section. Then from that section you need to assume some cover, you need to assume some steel diameter, and then you need to calculate how many number of steels are required, you need to calculate how many stirrups are required. So, all the parameters that are required to execute the beam, to construct the beam, everything you need to fix. So, that is our ultimate objective, right? That is the full fledged design problem. But what we will be doing is, let us not do the full fledged design problem here. We will break up the design problem, entire design problem, into small sub problems. Okay. sub problems means, like suppose a section is given to you, a design section is given to you, and you are asked to check whether a section is balanced section or under reinforced section, or a section is given to you, you are asked to calculate the moment of resistance of that section. Okay. Now, all these steps that you need to follow for checking over reinforced, under reinforced section, or calculating the moment of resistance, all these steps are required for the entire, for a full fledged design problems. Okay. Just to, so therefore, what to do? Let us understand those small steps, and if we understand those small steps, then we can assemble them, all these steps, to get the, to solve a design problem at the end of this lecture series. Okay. So, let us take these two problem, this is one problem, two problem, two sections are given. Okay. The first part is you need to check whether the following sections are under reinforced sections or over reinforced section, okay, and then determine the moment of resistance of these sections, okay. And the information that you have is grade of concrete is M25, means FCK is 25 megapascal, grade of steel is Fe415, means Fy is 415, Fy is 415. Okay. And then effective cover is 50 mm. Effective cover, we know that effective cover is essentially the from this to the center of the distance. This distance is effective cover. And we also know, so what we have here is, we have FCK is equal to 25 megapascal, that is given to us, and then Fy is equal to 415 megapascal, that is also given, 415 megapascal, these two information given. And for this, the capital D is equal to 300, effective cover is 50, so the effective depth will be 300 minus 50, 250. And for this, effective depth will be 400 minus 50, 350. Okay. So, let us see how we can calculate. The first, we'll do this part, check whether the following section is under reinforced section and over reinforced section. We'll see there are many ways we can check a section is under reinforced and over reinforced, but we'll start with the basic definition of under reinforced and over reinforced. The definition is if the amount of steel you are providing, it is less than the balance section, then it is under reinforced, and more than the balance section, this is over reinforced. This is how we check whether section is under reinforced and over reinforced. There are other ways as well. We can check based on the depth of neutral axis, we can check based on the moment of resistance, but those checks are derived from this basic rule. Okay. Now, so take the first example, this one, first example is this one. Okay. So, first calculate what is given to us is B, width of the section B is equal to 250 mm, okay. Do not forget to write unit, and capital D is given 300 mm, and effective cover is given 50, so small d becomes 300 minus 50 is equal to 250 mm, okay. And what is the area of steel? Now, please note that these are three number 16 torfi bar, okay, and this is two number 12 torfi bar. It means your numbers are three numbers bar. And 16 is the diameter of the bar, and this is the HYSD bar, and this is 212 is the diameter of the bar. Now, as per our sign convention, tension generates at the bottom, right, compression at the bottom. So, your tensile reinforcement is essentially this one, not this one. These bars are called holder bar or hanger bar. They are required to hold these ties, that we will see when we discuss stirrups. So, this is the this is the tensile reinforcement. It is very important to identify which one is the tensile reinforcement, the bottom one or top one. That depends on what kind of moment you are having, whether it is a sagging moment, hogging moment. And if you miss that, any mistake in this step will lead to a completely wrong and unsafe prediction. Okay. So, for this case, your AST is equal to then AST, area of steel for tension, is equal to 3 number 16 diameter bar. 16 diameter bar means pi by 4 into 16 square. This is equal to 603 mm square. You can check it. Okay. So, area of steel is given as this. So, what is the percentage of steel provided? Percentage of steel provided is AST divided by BD into 100. Please note, while calculating the percentage of steel, it is the effective depth we need to consider, not the overall depth. The reason is, this is how PT was defined in the expression. Okay. Now, if we substitute AST and BD, what you get is, you can check it, 0.965. This is the percentage of steel given to this section. Okay. Now, this is the percentage of steel actually given in this section, right? Now, what we need to check is, now we need to check whether that percentage of steel is lesser than the balance section or more than the balance section. So, let us check what is the percentage of steel for balance section. For balance section, now if you remember, this is the expression we had, for balance section. Now, this is how the PT can be calculated, and for balance section x u by d will be this value. Okay. And since it is Fe 415 grade steel, so x u by d, value of x u by d will be 0.48. So, for balance section, percentage of steel is, for balance section percentage of steel limiting, because that is the maximum steel you can give, beyond that, more than that, your section becomes over reinforced section. PT is equal to 41.38 x u limiting by d multiplied by f c k by f y. Okay. Now, what is x u limiting d? X u limiting d, just now we have checked, for Fe 415, this is 0.48. Okay. This is 0.48. So, you can substitute 0.48 here. If we substitute that, then what we have, 41.38 into 0.48, and f c k is 25, grade of steel is 25, you should write here, f c k is 25 megapascal, and f y is equal to 415 megapascal. And if you would substitute f c k, then 25 by 415, and you can do this calculation. This calculation, and this becomes approximately 1.2%. Okay. Now, means that percentage of steel that we have provided, this one is, this is the limiting percentage of steel. So, means the percentage of steel that we have provided, it is less than the percentage of steel for balance section, means our section is under reinforced section. So, this is less than PT limiting, and which gives us under reinforced section, under reinforced section. Okay. So, the first one is under reinforced section. Let us see what happens to the second one. Similar way you can do, I mean, you can parallel, you can also do it. Second one, the example is this. So, do the same exercise. B is equal to 300 mm. You can write first FCK is equal to FCK 25 megapascal, and then FY is equal to 415 megapascal, and then here B is equal to 300 mm, B is equal to 300 mm, capital D is equal to 400 mm, and small d is equal to 400 minus 50 is the clear cover. So, 400 minus 50, 350 mm, 350 mm. Okay. Now, so what is AST? AST here 5, AST here is 3 number 20 dia bar and 2 number 16, total 5 bars. Out of this 5, 3 bars are of 20 dia and 2 bars are of 16 dia. So, you have 3 into 2 into is equal to your AST is equal to 1344 mm square. Okay. And then percentage of steel, that is AST by B into D, AST is equal to this BD. We have this percentage of steel is around, you can calculate it. It is 1.28%. Okay. So, percentage of steel given is 1.28, and if you recall the limiting percentage, the PT limiting, no sorry, you have to find out PT. Now, let us find out what is PT limiting. PT limiting will be for balance section. PT limiting, we know PT limiting, calculate PT limiting. PT limiting will be your expression is this 41.38 XU by limiting D into FCK by FY. Okay. And this value is, yes, this value will be, it depends on, if you remember the PT limiting, at PT limiting value, this depends on only area of, only grade of concrete and grade of steel, and nothing else. It does not depend on the geometry of the section. So, in both the cases, in both the examples, the geometries are different, but in both the example these values are same. So, PT limiting for this will be same as for this, and we already obtained for PT limiting for the previous one, and that is 1.2%. Now, you check the PT limiting, now the provided reinforcement is now greater than PT provided reinforcement greater than PT limiting. So, therefore, the section is over reinforced section. So, gives us over section. So, the first one is under reinforced section and the second one is over reinforced section. And how we determine whether a section is under reinforced and over reinforced section? By checking the amount of steel provided in the section. Okay. This is the most, this is the basic definition of under reinforced and over reinforced section. But as I said, there are many ways you can check a section is over reinforced and under reinforced. This is essentially derived from this definition only, by checking whether the depth of neutral axis is less than the balance section or more than the balance section, the moment of resistance is less than or more than the balance section. So, those things I leave it to you to check how those rule can be applied for checking under reinforced and balance over reinforced section. Now, for the second part, we will stop here, we will take a quick 5 minutes break, and then after the break we will come and see how to determine the, now we have understood this is under reinforced, this is over reinforced section. Now, we will do the second part, find out how the moment of resistance for under reinforced section and over reinforced section can be determined. Okay. See you in 5 minutes. Thank you. Welcome back. So, what we were doing is we are trying to demonstrate the whatever we have learned so far through two examples. So, the examples are two sections are given. We have already checked this one is under reinforced section and this is over reinforced section. Now, what we have to do is the second part, finding moment of resistance for this and moment of resistance for this, right. Now, let us find out, let us see the expression for moment of resistance. Now, if you see this is for under reinforced, so this first one is under reinforced section. So, let us see the under reinforced section, how to determine the moment of resistance. You see the moment of resistance is this, right. If we can calculate what is x u by d and substitute x u by d in this expression to get the moment of resistance for under reinforced section. Okay. And for balance section, again I am repeating the same thing, for balance section if you substitute x u by d this value, we get this expression, a simplified form is this. So, these are the moment of resistance for balance section, but if it is under reinforced section we cannot use it because we cannot substitute x u by d by this, we need to calculate, we need to use this nonlinear equation. Okay, and we need to find out a way, we need to see how we can be how we can calculate x u by d. Okay. Now, you see we have already calculated, if you remember, we have already calculated for the first we have already calculated this is the percentage of steel, this is the percentage of steel, right. Now, we also know this expression, that what the expression between percentage of steel and x u by d. Okay. So, from this expression we can calculate what is the depth of neutral axis for the first section. Okay. So, let us do this. So, we know that that PT into FCK by FY is equal to 41.38 x u by d. So, this gives us x u by d is equal to 41.38 into percentage of steel for this section is 0.965, right. This is, and this is F y is 415 and then F c k is 25 and then 1 by 0.965 and this value is, and then this gives us x u is equal to x u by d, you can write this value is 0.387. Okay. X u by d is equal to yes. Yeah, this is there is a small mistake. This is F y by F c k. So, this becomes, sorry, this becomes 25 by, please correct it, 415. Okay. And this becomes 0.387. Okay. Now, this is x u by d. Now, once we know x u by d, let us substitute this x u by d in this expression, x u by d in this expression to get what is moment of resistance. And if you substitute that, we get mu is equal to 45.66 kilo Newton meter. Okay. Now, same thing you can do in a different way. For instance, we calculated x u by d from this expression. If you do not want, you can calculate x u by d by compression is equal to tension. We know that compression is equal to 0.36 F c k x u into b, and we know tension is equal to A s t into 0.87 F y. You, tension is equal to compression is equal to the it is the equilibrium equation, tension is equal to compression, and this gives you what is x u. Okay. So, essentially this expression is essentially the same as this. That is why either So, you if you do not remember this equation, in fact, you do not have to remember this equation, you directly calculate x u from this expression, because compression is equal to tension essentially gives you this. Okay. So, for the first one, the moment of resistance is this. Once you know x u, then you can calculate moment of resistance as compression into lever arm d minus a, compression into lever arm, right, compression into lever arm or tension into lever arm, right. And compression into lever arm and tension into lever arm essentially gives you this expression. So, these are same. So, you can calculate what is the moment of resistance for the first one. Now, for the second one, second one is we have checked this one is over reinforced section. Now, you see over reinforced section means what? You are giving amount of steel is more, so that the failure is governed by the concrete, not by steel. Okay. Now, you see, but also we know that irrespective of the values of amount of steel you give, your total strain in concrete, total strain in extreme concrete fiber remains same. Okay. Now, the when and for balance section, we also know that the failure is the both reaches their limit state, steel and concrete simultaneously. Okay. So, the limit state of concrete is fixed irrespective of the amount of steel you give. And what is that limit state of concrete? Limit state of concrete is the limit state that is reached at the balance section. Now, limit state of steel you can change by providing less amount of steel or less more amount of steel, or exactly giving the steel equal to the balance section. Okay. Now, so what happens if your section is over reinforced section and therefore, the limit state of steel reaches later, before that this concrete reaches its limit state. Therefore, the failure, moment of resistance, everything should be governed by the limit state of concrete. And what is the limit state of concrete? Limit state of concrete reaches the state reaches at the balance section. And therefore, if you find your section is over reinforced section, then the moment of resistance is essentially become the moment of resistance of the balance section. Because if you apply more moment than the balance section, then steel will not fail because you have given more steel, but it is the concrete which no longer can take additional moment because it has already reached its balance, its limit state. Therefore, if you find a section is over reinforced section, irrespective of the amount of steel you give, how much additional steel you give, your failure will be governed by concrete and the moment of resistance will be calculated based on failure of limit state of concrete, and which is essentially the moment of resistance of balance section. Now, since it is over reinforced section, so, moment of resistance of this will be governed by this. It is 415, grade of steel is this, and therefore, the moment of resistance will be this. So, for second one, moment of resistance will be, for the second one, moment of resistance will be 0.138 f c k b into d square. 0.138 into f c k is 25 into b is 250, b is 300 and d is 350 square, that is Newton mm, and this essentially becomes this is Newton mm. Please check the unit, and if you write it in kilonewton meter, it becomes 126.8 kilonewton meter. Okay.
This one, past problem dimension gives this answer.
Okay. So these become, please check this calculation. Okay. Now this is the moment of resistance for balance section. So you can write this is yes. Yes, this is the moment of resistance for balance. Oh yes, yes. Please, there is a small typo here. I mean, this expression when you write, this will be not x u by d. This will be d by x u. Okay, please check it. Sorry for this d by x u. This is d by x u. Okay. But this remains same. Okay. Now, so this is the moment of resistance for the second part, and you can write it is mu by limiting as well. It is mu limiting as well. Okay. So this is how you can check whether a section is balanced section, over reinforced section. This is how you can determine the depth of neutral axis of a section. Okay. So, this exercise is very important, because when you do a complete design problem and you will see the all these steps you need to find out, you choose a section, you need to find out whether the section is under reinforced and over reinforced, you need to ensure the section to be under reinforced section, therefore you need to determine the depth of neutral axis, and then you finally have to determine the moment of resistance, how much the section can offer. So all these things that we have done here, the small problems, all these exercises are required when you do actually entire design problem. So I suggest you just these two problems are not enough. If you take any book, there are many examples given, and you need to solve those examples, otherwise things will not be clear. Okay. Now there is a question here. It says that the two question, but two question has a very similar essence. One is doubly reinforced section is over reinforced section? This is one question, and the second question is most of the construction prefer doubly reinforced section. Well, you are right, most of the sections are doubly reinforced section in industry what we use, but without understanding the principle of without mechanics of under reinforced section, we cannot understand what is doubly reinforced section. Without understanding what is singly reinforced section, we cannot understand what is doubly reinforced section. Therefore, the first 3 and 4 hours are spent to understand what is under reinforced section and singly reinforced section. Okay. Tomorrow we will find some time to discuss what is over reinforced section. This was the second addressing the second part. The first part is whether a doubly reinforced section is over reinforced section. No, it cannot be said like this. Whenever we see that our section is becoming over reinforced, in order to avoid that, what we do is we provide some steel. Your moment of resistance for balance section is the maximum moment of resistance. Beyond that, you cannot achieve. But suppose your required moment of resistance is more than that. How you can achieve that, how you can increase the moment of resistance, you can change the dimension of the section. But suppose for many architectural constraint, you cannot have that flexibility to change the cross section of the beam. So that measure cannot be taken. One way by intuitively you can say that, okay, then increase the amount of steel, but increasing amount of steel does not work, because then your section becomes over reinforced section, that is not acceptable. Okay. But you need to somehow increase the moment of resistance, because that is required for you. Okay, the induced moment is more than the moment the section is offering. In that case, and it happens in most of the practical purposes. In that case, what we do is we go for doubly reinforced section. What is doubly reinforced section? All the examples that we have done so far and the equations that we have derived here, the reinforcement, the main reinforcement, tensile reinforcement, is given only at one point, right? Most of the examples that we have seen at the bottom, tension, wherever you have tension. but you can increase the moment of resistance by providing some amount of steel at the compression side as well, and equivalent amount of steel at the additional steel at the tensiles at the tensile zone as well, and that will increase your moment of resistance without, and but your section will not be, your failure of the section, failure of the beam will not be brittle in nature, the ductility will be ensured. And how to do that in W reinforced section, that will be discussed tomorrow. Okay. Okay. So, moving on, the next part is, so this is all for design of the, as far as the equations are concerned, the principle is concerned, this is for design of for beam for flexure. Now, next what we do is design for shear. We have not, again please please note, we have not done any design so far, but all these exercises that we have been doing, that is very important to understand the design design steps. Okay, it is just design steps is essentially the combination of the, all these exercises. Okay, so design for shear, so let us understand what happens when a beam section is subjected to shear force. Okay. Now, you see, take a same beam, simply supported beam, just for representation purpose, which is subjected to transverse load like this. Okay, and then you take any cross section, any small cross section. Okay, this is a small cross section. Okay. Now, suppose in this small cross section, these are the shear forces, this is the shear force, and in order to maintain the equilibrium, you are familiar with equation for static equilibrium, and equation of static equilibrium says that summation of forces in all directions at 0 and summation of moments about any axis at 0. Now, what happens is, you take a section, you take a small section here, and we know that our shear force is like this. Shear force, this is the way we define positive shear force. Okay, now equilibrium equation says that summation of forces in all direction is equal to 0, I am not writing any direction explicitly here, and summation of moment about any axis is 0. And now, you see, if you take, if this is V, if this is V and this is also V, so if we take summation of forces in x direction is 0, summation of forces in x direction, if x is 0 anywhere, there is no force in x direction. Please remember, we are assuming there is no bending here, only the bending force, bending stresses are now isolated. Okay, it is only for shear. Okay, now let us see summation of Fy. Summation of Fy is also 0, it is V and this is negative V, so this is also 0, there is no z axis, so this is satisfied. Let us see summation of moment is 0 or not. If you take moment about this axis, then we or any about if this length is A, if this length is A, then we will see that summation of moment, about this point, about any point, if you can take summation of moment is not equal to 0 in this axis. So, equilibrium is not maintained here. So, what will, what this section will do in order to maintain the equilibrium, you need also an, it is a clockwise couple. And the clockwise couple is V into A, a clockwise couple produced. In order to balance this clockwise couple, you need an anticlockwise couple. Okay, and this anticlockwise couple is like this. This anticlockwise couple is this. So this is also V. This is also V. Now this will produce the, this will balance this clockwise couple and maintain the equilibrium. Okay, so therefore, if you take any cross section, any cross section here, your shear forces are like this. Okay, so all these sides, your shear forces are like this. Great. Now, what happens? I told it was discussed yesterday also that now resultant of this shear force and this shear force will be in this direction, and resultant of this and this will be in this direction. So, they will produce a compression on this diagonal. Okay, resultant of this and resultant of this produce a compression on this diagonal. And similarly, resultant of these two shear forces and resultant of these two shear forces will produce tension on this diagonal. Okay. So, this is called diagonal compression and this is called diagonal tension. Now, concrete is strong in compression that and weak in tension, or rather we assume there is no tensile strength of concrete. So, whenever tension generates on this diagonal, concrete cannot take this tension and it cracks like this, the crack forms like this. Okay. Now, why these cracks are formed? These cracks are formed because of the tension generated on this diagonal, and this tension is generated because of the shear crack. So, essentially though we call it shear crack, essentially it is not directly due to shear. Shear produces tension, local tension on this diagonal, and it is that tension which causes the crack on this, crack along this diagonal. Now, we do not want this crack to form, or we need something to take care of this tension, and how this tension can be taken care of by providing some steel across this diagonal. Okay. So, either we can provide a steel along this diagonal, this along this diagonal. So, whatever tension comes, this tension is taken by this diagonal steel. This is one way of providing shear reinforcement, but more common approach is, instead of providing a diagonal steel, we provide a vertical steel like this. Those are called stirrups. We will come to this point shortly. So, we provide these steel bars, then these steel bars take care of this diagonal, this tension on this diagonal. Okay. Now, so what this, just to give a summary of this, is if it is subjected to shear, pure shear, this pure shear causes compression on this diagonal, tension on this diagonal, and tension cannot be taken by concrete, and this tension is taken by steel. But you put a star mark on this figure. We will come to this figure once again, because you see, we say that concrete is strong in compression, absolutely fine, but its strength in compression is not infinite. Okay. So, how much, therefore, the shear force cannot be infinite. We cannot increase the shear force beyond a certain limit, because if the shear force is increased beyond a certain limit, that will produce compression on this diagonal such that that compression is more than the compressive strength of the concrete. Therefore, there is a maximum shear we can allow a section to have. So, we will come to this point when we discuss about what is that maximum shear and how that shear can be taken into account while designing for shear reinforcement. For the time being, we put a star mark here. Okay. For the timing, we are interested only in these two figures. Okay. We have tension on this diagonal and then providing reinforcement to take care of this tension. Okay. So, but you know, this is an important thing. You see, when we design a section for shear, by the time we start designing a section for shear, we have already designed a section for flexure. Okay. So, section is already having this longitudinal reinforcement, right. These reinforcements are for flexural reinforcement. These are for taking a longitudinal tension. Now, what happens? Now, these are the cracks generated due to shear force, diagonal cracking, that is just now we discussed. Now, consider two situations where you do not have these rods, these steel bars, and a situation where you have these steel rods. Okay. Just by intuition, we can say, again without any design of structure and analysis of structure course. By intuition, we can say that whatever shear generated, these cracks generated, these longitudinal presence of longitudinal reinforcement will prevent these cracks to generate, or in another way we can say these presence of longitudinal reinforcement in some way enhances the shear resistance capacity of this section. Okay. So, this the presence of the, so we have two situation where is there is no longitudinal reinforcement, and then longitudinal reinforcement because of the presence of longitudinal, concrete has some shear strengths. Okay. Now, because of the presence of longitudinal reinforcement, the section, the shear resisting capacity of the section is slightly enhanced. Okay. And this is very important because while calculating the strength of a section, this part, this contribution, shear resistance contribution will be taken into account. Okay. Now, okay. So, this is table number 19 of IS-456. This is a very important table, both table number 19 and then table number 20. What table number 19 says, just it is just the same thing. What we have seen here, the presence of tensile reinforcement enhances the shear resistance capacity of the section, or presence of reinforcement gives or it has some shear resistance capacity. Table number 19 gives you exactly that. What it gives you? The percentage of steel. So, naturally your the enhancement, how much shear resistance is enhanced, that depends on how much longitudinal reinforcements you provide. So, it depends on the percentage of steel, right. Now, this is the percentage of steel for different percentage of steel and for different grades of concrete, and this gives you what is the shear resistance of section. These values are in megapascal. For instance, if your percentage of steel is 0.25 and your grade of concrete is M25, then the presence of longitudinal reinforcement gives you shear resistance of 0.36 MPa. So, whatever shear stress comes in the section, out of that 0.36 MPa is already offered by the longitudinal reinforcement. Whatever balance, whatever rest amount, for that amount you need to design shear force. You need to design shear reinforcement. Okay. Now, so this table is very important. Those who are having a copy of IS-456, please go through this table. Then next, so let's see understand what is the philosophy. This is a section where you have a shear force. This is our positive shear force. Shear force is V, effective depth is D, and width is B. Okay. So, what happened? Nominal shear stress is, this term is very important, nominal. Why it is nominal, I will tell you shortly. You see, if you remember in strength of material course, that if you have a section, if you have a beam, if you have a cross section, if you have a beam which is subjected to, say, any beam, you take a simply supported beam subjected to any kind of load, any load like this, and then if I take a section, beam section is a rectangular section, and this is the depth of neutral axis, then we know that the bending stress is m by i into y. Okay. This is the bending stress. Okay. Now, and this is for rectangular section, this is the distribution, which is maximum at the extreme fibers and 0 at the neutral axis. Okay. And how the shear stress distribution for this cross section, shear stress distribution is parabolic, something like this. Okay. If you know that tau is equal to vq by i b, this expression you probably are familiar with. Now, your shear stress is 0 at this point and maximum at the neutral axis. Okay. Now, so this is the distribution of shear stress and this is the distribution of bending stress. Now, actually total shear stress on this cross section will be integration of the entire this multiplied by the width of the section. Okay. Now, this gives you the actual shear stress on the section, total shear force on the section, but as far as shear stress is concerned, its shear stress is different at different depth. Okay. But for design purpose, what we do is we assume the shear stress is, we do not assume shear stress is parabolic. What we assume is shear, we assume a rectangular distribution of stress. Okay. So, shear stress is uniform across the depth, and this shear stress is called, and this shear stress is total shear force is V, and the cross section is B into the width into effective depth. Mind it, if all these design purposes we use effective depth, not the overall depth. This is the shear stress, but this shear stress is not the actual shear stress at any particular, this is a nominal shear stress or average shear stress. Okay. So, this the term average that you see here, the nominal that you see here, this is nominal shear stress, and it is expressed as tau v. This is the standard standard way we define tau v. So, when we say tau v, it is implicit that this shear stress is nominal shear stress. Okay. And as okay. Now, so what you do is, for a given cross section, you know what is the shear stress coming onto this on a section. Okay. Now, out of that shear stress, some amount of shear stress is already some amount of shear strength already offered by the presence of longitudinal reinforcement, and this is denoted as tau c. So, tau c is the shear stress offered by the concrete. Okay. And tau v is the shear stress coming onto the section, induced on the section. Okay. Then we have different, we have three scenario. These three scenario is very important. Now, one thing is written here is this tau v cannot be greater than tau c max. See, this is tau c. This table 19 gives you tau c. Okay. Now, but this shear stress cannot be tau c max. Now, what is tau c max? Table number 20 gives you tau c max for different grade of concrete, but do not take it for granted. Table number 2, let us understand why this tau c max. What it says, that your shear stress at any section cannot be greater than a specified value. Now, the question is why it cannot be greater than a specified value. We again go back to this, I told you put a star mark here. Now, let us come to this figure. We discuss, you see, if we keep on increasing shear stress, what will happen? Compression on this diagonal increases and tension on this diagonal increases. Okay. Tension on this diagonal increases, it is not a problem for us, because whatever tension comes, we are anyway providing, we are not depending on concrete to take the tension, right. What we are doing to take the tension, we provide the reinforcement, steel reinforcement. So, if the tension is more, you provide more reinforcement. Okay. But for compression, we rely on concrete to take the compression. But what happens, concrete is strong in compression, but still it has a finite compressive strength, right. So, if you keep on increasing shear stress, which will cause increase in compression on this diagonal, one situation may happen, or you may arise a point where your shear stress is such, the shear force is such, the generated compressive stress on this diagonal is more than the strength of this concrete. Okay, compressive strength of this concrete. Then what happens? Then the concrete will fail in crushing. Okay. So, we want an upper limit of this shear stress. Okay. And that upper limit is tau c max, and this tau c max is these values. Okay. And these values are obtained, these are the material properties, these values are obtained from experiment. Okay. For different grades of concrete, these are the values of tau c max. Okay. So, in any circumstances, your tau v cannot be greater than tau c max. If you find your tau v is greater than tau c max, immediately you have to change the section. No amount of shear resistance will solve this problem. Okay. Now, suppose now your tau v is less than tau c max, and in that case you have two situations. One is tau v is less than tau c. Tau v is less than tau c means what? Tau c is what? Tau c is the amount the section has some shear resistance because of the presence of longitudinal reinforcement. If that shear resistance is more than the shear stress on the section, so naturally we don't need any additional reinforcement for shear, right? So, no shear reinforcement required theoretically, but in spite of that you need to provide some minimum amount of reinforcement as per clause number of IS 456. Another situation is tau v is greater than tau c, means your induced shear stress on the section is greater than the shear resistance of the section. Now, in that case what? You need to design shear reinforcement only for this amount of shear, this much of shear, okay. Because tau c is already among out of tau v, tau c amount is already taken care by the longitudinal reinforcement. It is the balance amount, that is tau v minus tau c, that needs to be considered for shear reinforcement. So, essentially you have three situations. One is depending, so essentially we have three parameters. One is tau v. One is tau v, then tau c, and then tau c max. So, depending on these values, you have three cases. Case one is that tau v is greater than tau c max, means your the tau c max is the maximum shear stress that you can have in concrete, but your applied shear stress is more than that. So, this cannot be done. So, you need to do a revise the section, okay. Now, then case 2 is tau v less than tau c max. So, in this is allowed. Now, even in case 2, you have two situations. One situation is situation 2a is what? Your tau v is less than tau c, this tau c means what? Means your applied shear stress is less than resistance. So, what is this? No shear reinforcement. Reinforcement theoretically, but you have to provide minimum reinforcement as per IS 456. And 2b, so when you design for shear, you have to check these three steps in the same order. Tau v greater than tau c, and this gives you shear reinforcement required only for tau v minus tau c. Okay. These are the three cases. Okay. Now, okay. So what we need is for this first and second case, this case is you have to revise the entire section. For this case, we need to provide a minimum shear reinforcement as per IS 456. So, calculation is not required, no shear reinforcement theoretically required. Only it is this case where you need to design shear reinforcement. And let us consider now this case. These two cases are not required. Okay. Now, suppose as I mentioned in one of the slide, this is the cracks, diagonal cracks you can have. Okay, I assume it is a 45 degree crack if it is subjected to pure shear, and then you can have reinforcement either in vertical reinforcement or is diagonal reinforcement. Okay, now suppose if this is effective depth, then if you assume it is a 45 degree angle, then from this point to this point, this is effective, this is also small d. Okay. Now, suppose within this small d, these are the different reinforced, different steel bars, different shear reinforcement you are given at a spacing of SV. Okay. SV is the spacing between stirrups. Then within this small, within this d distance, within this entire crack length d distance, how many stirrups, how many bars you are providing? The number of bars you have provided in is equal to d by SV. Okay. So, this is the number of bars, so either vertical or inclined bars you provided. Let us consider for vertical bar. Okay. So, now these are the vertical bars. Okay. These are the vertical bars. Now, the difference you see, these bars has two legs. This is one leg and this is two leg. Two legs means it has two vertical components, and this is the vertical, it is the vertical components which provide shear resistance, right, which takes this shear force. Okay. Now, this has two vertical two legs, so it is called two leg stirrups. Similarly, in this case you have four vertical components, this is called four leg stirrups. Similarly, you can have three leg, five leg, depending on the requirement and the cross section. Okay. Now, suppose this is the amount of shear that is required for design. Tau c is the resistance offered by the section, and tau v is the induced. The balance amount of shear stress multiplied the cross section, this gives you the total shear force that is required for design. Now, in this entire shear force that has to be taken by this entire force that has to be taken by this vertical stirrups. Now, for each rod, what is the limit state, what is the design strength? 0.87 into FY, we know that. And ASV is the area of steel. Okay. Area for two leg stirrups, area of steel means area of this plus area of this. Four leg stirrups is area of this plus this plus this plus this. ASV gives you that. So, this is the total force for one bar, and within a distance you have n number of bars. So, this is the amount of resistance that is provided by n number of bar, that should be equal to the induced forces. And then if you, from this we get SV is equal to this, S spacing is equal to this. So, the shear resistance will be, you assume what is the diameter of the bar, and what is the, how many legs you want to give. If it is two legs, then it is the diameter, phi is the diameter of the bar, this is SV, it is four leg, this is SV. Similarly, if it is three leg, instead of four it becomes three. So, SB is known, FY is known, tau V, tau C, B is known. So, with this we can calculate what is the spacing required for stirrup. This is, we assume, a vertical stirrups. Okay. Now, if they are inclined stirrups, then there is some modification in the code suggested, but we are not introducing formally the code right now. We will spend 5-10 minutes to introduce the code to see what are the different clauses and where you get what information. There we see what additional modification you need when your stirrups are not vertical, if they are inclined. Okay. So, this is the example, this is the theory for design of beam for shear. What we do is we stop here today. Tomorrow what we do is we will start with one example of shear force, one example of shear design, and then we quickly see what is doubly reinforced section. All the equations that we derived for singly reinforced section required for doubly reinforced section with slight modification. And then finally, we will have a discussion session for entire thing that we covered in this lecture series. Okay. So, with this I stop here. If you have any specific question, so we can address that specific question as far as whatever discussion today. Okay. এখন বলবো না পরে বলে দেবো বলে দাও উইল ডিসকাস প্রুফ স্টেস আর কোনো প্রশ্ন আছে? Yeah, if you have any specific question as far as related to whatever discussion we have today, please you can raise your hand. Or some of the question you asked, but what we do is all these question we'll write to you and give you the detailed explanation. তাই তো ওইগুলো আমরা লিখে দিয়ে দেবো, আর ফিগার ফিগার কিছু নেই এখানে. That's okay. Check question, any question.
Are we provide inclined shear reinforcement? Are we provide inclined shear reinforcement?
Yeah, why you provide inclined shear reinforcement? Actually, we don't, nowadays we don't provide inclined shear reinforcement. We prefer vertical stirrup, because from practical point of view, it is more easy to provide vertical stirrups than the inclined reinforcement. And but yes, if you want to provide inclined reinforcement, you can provide. You can provide, because this is the crack diagonally. This is the diagonal crack you can see. So the effective way will be providing the reinforcement normal to this crack surface. Okay, and normal to the crack surface is this diagonals. Okay, in a diagonal direction. But it may not be that effective, because you assume these diagonals are 45 degree angle, because it is pure shear. But your cracks, but you have shear force, combination of shear force, bending moment, also your cracks may not be exactly diagonal always. And providing these inclined stirrups is also sometimes very, most of the time it is very difficult from keeping practical keeping practical purpose. So we actually provide mostly the vertical stirrups. That's why I discussed only the vertical stirrups. But if anyone wants to provide inclined stirrups, what modification required, that is given in the code, and we'll show you the required modification. In that case, what you have to do is you have to take the force in this direction, take the sine and cos component, and then when you balancing the forces, instead of taking the force, you have to take the force, you have to take the component of the force, and therefore in the expression you have a sine and cos term there. What is your question? Mane?
This was on the way I have raised hand. Jalo,
raise hand. Check the key. What is it? Chalo. Raise hand karin yaar. Yes, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, morning.
Is there any difference between the strength of two leg stirrups and four leg stirrups?
Strength of two leg stirrups and, okay, let us see the documents. If the strength, when we talk about strength, it is 0.87 FY is the strength of material. Now, if it is multiplied by the area of steel, then gives you the total force taken by this section. Now, for two leg stirrups, this ASB is this, and for four leg stirrup, ASB is this. So, your strength remains same, 0.87 FY, but since the area is more now, so effectively the amount of force can be taken by four leg stirrups is now more than the two leg stirrup. Okay. Now, having said that, it is not that let us use four leg stirrup irrespective of the cross section of the beam. There are specifications like you should have a minimum distance between this minimum distance between these two stirrups, maximum distance between these two stirrups. Okay, minimum distance between these two longitudinal bars. So therefore, whether you provide two leg stirrups, three leg stirrups, four leg stirrups, it depends on one, whether you really need it or not, because it depends on the how much shear stress you have, one. Second thing is whether your section allow you to have four leg stirrups or three leg stirrups. If your section is very narrow, weight is very small, then you may not be having sufficient dimension to have multiple leg stirrups. On the other hand, if your width of the cross section is very large, then even though you need two leg stirrups, you may have to use more leg stirrups, because you cannot have, there is a specification between maximum distance between two stirrups. So, you cannot place stirrups the legs more than a specified distance. Okay. So, in a short, strength remains same, but the since the area is more, therefore, the load carrying capacity is more for four leg stirrups. But whether we provide two leg, four leg or any leg stirrup, that depends not only on the amount of shear force, it also depends on the cross section of the beam.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Any other questions? Okay, if any other question, we can go to other. Hello.
Hello, sir. I have a doubt.
Yes, please.
That assumptions, we said that the spline is linearly varying,
yes,
but the thrust work is parabolic in shape. What's the reason for choosing a parabolic shape?
The assumption of the cross section, you are saying? The plane section remain plane, that assumption you are talking about?
No, the strain is linearly varying.
Strain
is actually parabolic.
Okay.
So said that strain is linearly varying.
Yes. No, what is your question? Tell me.
But this, the stress block is parabolic in shape. That not specified in the assumption.
Which one? Cross section or what?
Stress block of beam, cross section of beam.
Okay, I mean, just go back to the document. Are you talking about this? Are you talking about this?
Not sir, during the derivation of neutral axis depth, we take first diagram as a parabolic in shape.
Stress diagram, okay.
First block.
Okay, just wait a minute, huh? Okay, this one?
Yes, that one. Why we choose a parabolic variation?
This parabolic variation?
Yes.
Why this one is parabolic? That is your question?
Yes, why we choose the parabolic variation?
Yeah, this stage diagram, why this stage diagram is parabolic? That is your question?
Yes.
Yes, okay, it you see, it again comes from. Yeah, you see, this is your strain, right? This is your strain, and this is the corresponding stress. Now, this strain and stress comes from this diagram, the variation of stress strain relation of concrete, and this is obtained from experiment that it is or idealized the idealization of the experimental stress strain behavior. That from this, from between this strain to from 0 to 0 this strain, your relation is parabolic, that is obtained from experiment, okay, this parabolic relation, and then it is remain constant, this is idealization. And that is why what happened here, your strain is 0 and here your strain is 0.002. So, between this point to this point, it is parabolic, that is why it is parabolic between this point to this point, and from this to this, it is constant, that is why it is constant, and that is why this stress distribution we get up to this constant and then parabolic. And if does it help? I mean, is it that you are asking?
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Is any other question from your Yes.
Yeah, sir. May I know why do we give a limit to the clear cover of sections? What will happen if we do not give a maximum limit to the clear cover?
Why do we leave clear cover?
Yeah, we provide a clear cover to the sections, right?
Yes.
So may I know what will happen if we build it without giving a maximum limit to the clear cover? Is there any reason for that?
Without giving no clear cover or without giving more clear cover?
What will happen if we give more clear cover? That's a maximum limit to the clear cover we provide. So
not only maximum, there is a limited minimum limit as well. You have to give, see the thing is, first let's talk about minimum. The minimum clear cover relation you have to give, because if you see, you see for instance you see this figure, okay. Now if your clear cover is very small, then what will happen, that it may come out and then your reinforcement is exposed to the environment, right? So which you do not want, and then suppose you want to, that so there is a minimum limit. Now if you give very large clear cover, for instance if clear cover is 200 mm clear cover, then what will happen, suppose you are using it for slab, that clear cover is wastage because it will unnecessarily increase the dead load, and what will happen, the portion of the concrete below the reinforcement, again because of the dead load, it will come out and your reinforcement will be exposed to the weather, okay. So there is a minimum limit of the clear cover because you do not want reinforcement to be exposed to the environment, and that in depending on the environment, that minimum limit to be specified. Maximum limit because it is wastage, you do not want unnecessarily providing clear cover 100 mm, because it will increase the cross section, it will increase the dead load, and many cases because of the increase in the cross section, your essentially your it will contribute to the failure of the structure. Unnecessary your structure will be, you need to design unnecessary your structure with for overestimated load, okay. That is why when you give clear cover, yes, minimum limit and maximum limit both needs to be seen.
Yes.
Okay, any other question from this section, or we can see other section if they have any question.
Hi sir.
Hi.
As you were saying, sir, if section is over reinforced,
yes.
If section is over reinforced, we design for balance section. Why not we?
Why?
Why not we go for balance? The section is over reinforced, we design for balance section. Why not go for under reinforced?
No. You are. Okay. It is not what we design. What we said is, a design is given to you, okay. Reinforcement is given, section is given, everything is given to you. Now you want to assess the strength of that section. It is not we are designing it. When we design it, we will definitely go for first preference under reinforced section, okay. Over reinforced we will not go. But the example that we discussed, that is the assessment of the strength, okay. Now if you found that for the given reinforcement, your reinforcement is more than the balance section, means what? Means reinforcement will not, steel reinforcement will not fail first, right? Means your section is essentially over reinforced, reinforcement is given more than the balance section, okay. Therefore, the additional reinforcement that you give more than the balance section, though they will reduce the strain in steel, they will make the steel safer, but they as far as the failure of entire structure is concerned, they will not contribute anything. This is meaningless, because before that concrete will fail. As long as it reaches the balance moment of resistance, concrete fails. So, even after that, if you provide additional steel, it is meaningless for the section. Okay. So, when you do assessment of the strength of a section, and if you find that reinforcement is given more than the balance section, then additional reinforcement we do not consider for assessment. Okay, because they are minimal, they are irrelevant, because before that concrete will fail, and therefore the failure of section has to, other assessment of the section has to be made based on the failure of concrete. Okay, now. Failure of concrete means when the concrete reaches its limit state, and when concrete reaches its limit state, when the section becomes balanced section. So, limit state of a balanced section is same as the limit state of concrete, reaching limit state of concrete. That is why if you found for the assessment, if you found that your section is over reinforced section, then the strength of the section is governed by the failure of concrete, or that has to be calculated based on the balance section, because beyond balance section the additional amount of steel has no effect on the strength contribution. That is why it is for balance section. Now, when you come to design, if we check that a section is over reinforced, we make the section under reinforced by changing the dimension of the cross section. This is our first thing we can do, but if we see even by changing the dimension it does not work, then we can go for doubly reinforced section. Or many practical cases do not make under reinforced section, always go for doubly reinforced, do not make singly reinforced section, always go for doubly reinforced section. Okay. So, that is for design, but nowhere we make our section over reinforced. I do not know whether this clarifies your doubt, confusion.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so if you and no other questions, we can go to other center and check.
Hello.
Yeah, hello.
Hello.
Yeah, hello.
Hello.
Yes, I can hear you.
Ah, sir. What is partial safety factor for ready mix concrete?
What is partial safety factor for ready mix concrete? Ready mix concrete, what is partial safety factor? Do you have anything? Partial safety, see, as far as, okay, let us see, I cannot, I have not seen, maybe ready mix concrete, if it is made in a very controlled way, where the all the parameters, all the ingredients are taken from similar sources for which it is designed, you may probably reduce the partial safety factor for concrete. But what is the value right now, I cannot tell you. I have to check whether is there any specific partial safety factor for ready mix concrete or not. But definitely, I'll tell you the values tomorrow.
But can it possible to minimize it from 1.5 to 1.25 or 1.1?
Well, why not? I mean, the thing is, you see, okay. So you want to reduce the safety factor for concrete. Okay, like steel, we have less safety factor. In principle, it is yes. Theoretically, you can. Because if you have a concrete which is made in a very standard environment, whether you take any sample, the variability is very less. Okay, then of course, why not? In principle, you can do, but practically, whether that can be achieved or not, the variability can be how to what extent it can be minimized, like steel or any other synthetic material which is made in a very manufactured in a very controlled environment in industry. where the variability is very less. But yes, if you can somehow theoretically, I am saying, if you can reduce the variability, you can think of reducing it, but in practically how much it is, to what extent it is possible, I am doubtful. That we have to see. Yes, I can see you and hear you.
So how exactly we can find the value of strain with in the stress diagram, sir, with a constant, where it just changes from the constant, sir?
Which one? Which one? How we can find the?
So there's no audio, sir.
I can hear you properly.
Hello, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Yeah, here.
Hello.
Yes, I can hear you.
Hello, sir.
Yes, I can hear you. Hello.
Good morning, sir.
Morning. Good morning.
Yes. Why do we call it partial factor of safety?
Why do?
Not just factor of. Why do we call it partial factor of safety, not just factor of safety?
Okay, the partial, because okay, you know the meaning of partial, right? Meaning of partiality. Okay, partiality means what? Partiality means what? It is not equal, right? You are giving more weightage to someone or more preference to someone than the other, then you become partial, right? Now, with the same concept here, it is called partial factor of safety because this factor of safety is not uniform. It is you are doing a partiality while assigning this factor of safety. And what kind of partiality? You are assigning a different safety factor for concrete, you are assigning different safety factor for steel, you are assigning different safety factor for dead load, live load, you are assigning different safety factor for wind load, earthquake load. So, because these safety factors are not different, you are giving preference to one than the other, that is why this term called partial safety factor, not the safety factor. Now, your next question may come. Why not give the same safety factor for all? The reason is, you see, because the for instance, the material, concrete is a material which is most of the time mixed at the construction site, and the strength of the material depends on the many other ingredients, and all these ingredients are natural products, right? So you have variability in their strength, in their characterization. You have variability. You take sand from one source, and then tomorrow you take sand from other sources. Two different sources of sand gives you different properties, slightly some statistical variation. So you have the uncertainty associated with concrete is more as compared to the steel, which is manufactured in a very controlled, very standardized, where your composition can be controlled in a very precise way. So naturally, the variability will be less for steel. Therefore, since their variability are different, uncertainty is different, then the why to give the same safety factor to all? So we give more safety factor to for concrete and less to steel. Similarly, for different kinds of load, or dead load and live load, always you have on the structure. But whereas the wind load or earthquake load, they have their occurrence time. in the, it may so happen that within the span of life, within lifespan of a structure, they may come, they may not come, and sometimes if they come, the severity associated with the earthquake load may be different than the severity associated with dead load and live load. So every loads had their different contribution. So therefore, why to give a same factor of safety to all different loads? It gives different partial factor of safety to different loads. That's why this is called partial factor of safety. Okay. Whereas in the other the working stress method, somebody asked in the last class what is working stress method, load factor method. I suggested him to please go through the book at least for 1 hour, first chapter of any reinforced concrete design book. There you will see the for those methods we do have a same factor of safety for everything. Okay. There we used to call it factor of safety, that's it. But since here you have different factors for different thing, that's why it is called partial factor of safety. I think is it clear your confusion?
Yes, sir. One more question.
Yes, please.
Is there any advantage of WSM over LSM?
Is there any advantage of WSM over LSM or LSM over WSM? WSM, okay, advantage WSM is the WSM is more conservative. LSM, what you do is you allow the structure to reach its limit state. Means you are maximizing the behavior of the structure. Means you are taking maximum out of the structure, out of the material. That is LSM. Okay, so it is more towards in terms of economical, your structure will be more economical. But we do use WSM in many cases. For instance, in many cases we don't want our structure to reach its limit state. One of the limit state is suppose the cracking, serviceability limit state, right? So in working stress method is we do allow some amount of cracking in the structure. Okay, some amount of cracking in the structure, but in many structure we don't want the structure to have crack. For instance, many water retaining structure. Okay, even a small amount of crack you don't want. In that case, what? In that case, we have to make our structure more conservative. We cannot allow our structure even to reach the limit state. In those cases, we do use working stress method or the similar philosophy. Okay, so that is, and more detailed, as I said, working stress and limit state method, their advantages, disadvantages, please go through books once, and their basic underlying principles and things will be clear. Any book you take, the first chapter gives you the information. By the way, do you have a copy of any book, any concrete book?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, all of you. I mean, I can see many people around 10, 12 I can see. So all of you are having a copy of Design of Architecture book.
Yes, sir.
Yes, that's good. Okay, thank you. What is the condition for under condition for under reinforced? কথা বল বলবো ওকে তারপরে
ক্যান উই প্রোভাইড থ্রি বার স্টিরাপ
দেয়ার ইজ এ কোশ্চেন ক্যান উই প্রোভাইড থ্রি লেগ বার অ্যাজ স্টিরাপস ইয়েস ইউ ক্যান প্রোভাইড থ্রি লেগ বার অ্যাজ স্টিরাপস ইফ ইট ইজ রিকোয়ার্ড অ্যান্ড ইফ ইউর সেকশন অ্যালাউ ইউ টু ডু সো ইয়েস ইউ ক্যান How to, there is a question called how to reduce deflection while designing for flexure. Okay, you see, there are two things. Deflection depends on what? Deflection depends on, it depends on, for instance, there is a question is how we can reduce the deflection while designing. Designing a section. Now, for instance, okay, take an example of a simply supported beam, okay, and subjected to say UDL, uniformly distributed loads, which is Q, and length of the beam is say L. So, we know that the deflection will be maximum at the mid span, and that deflection W or y it is equal to Q L to the power 4 by 384 E I. That is the expression you have already you already know from structural analysis. This is the maximum deflection. Now, your question is, suppose we are designing a simply supported beam. Now, while designing, how for flexure or shear, take as a whole, while designing how we can reduce the deflection. Now, your answer lies in this expression itself. Now, how you can reduce the deflection? One way is, you see, you increase the Young's modulus. But Young's modulus you cannot increase. Young's modulus, increasing Young's modulus means you have to change the material, you have to change the grade of concrete. Okay, this is one way, but that it may not be that effective. Another way is you change the second moment of area of a beam. Okay, second moment of area I is what for a rectangular beam? I is B H cube by 12, where B is the width, H is the depth of the section, cross section. And so this is I. So you can increase the I. You can increase the I. The deflection will be reduced. How we can increase the I? You can increase the I by increasing the width or increasing the depth of the beam. Increasing the width will not affect much because it is linearly dependent on I. But increasing the width will be more effective. Increasing the depth will be more effective. So if you increase the depth by 2, your I will be reduced by 8, I will be increased by 8, and similarly Y will be reduced by 1 by 8. Okay. So, this is one approach. Another way is you decrease the length of the beam, but decrease length of the beam may not be possible because you already know what is the length of the beam. There is the architecture of the plan or architecture of the building is already freezed. Okay. So, this may not be the viable approach. E, changing E may not be the as effective as effective. Changing B is one approach, changing thickness is depth of the beam is another approach. So, these are the things you can do while designing a big cross section. But when you design a cross section, if you see IS 456, there are some guidelines while choosing B and H, okay, how to reduce deflection. And if we follow that guideline, then to some extent it is ensured that your deflection will be less. But first we design for shear, design for limit state of collapse, and when it is done we also check whether the limit state of serviceability is satisfied or not. We calculate the deflection and we say that if we find that deflection is more than the specified limit, then these are some options we can do. Changing the cross section, changing the reinforcement also is one way, but let us wait for some time. When we come to that section, we will discuss changing the reinforcement has some effect. Okay, hope it helps. Okay, if you we will stop here now. Tomorrow we will start with one example on design of shear and then see quickly outline what are the steps for doubly reinforced section. And then we can have more general discussion on the entire topic that we have covered. Okay. Thank you. See you tomorrow.